Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison for GI. We are here at GI Towers. We are shooting on location. Apologies about the slightly late start. We've had some, let's just say, some technical issues. So what I'm relying on you guys to do is to let me know in the comments what you're hearing. Let me know if you're hearing me loud and clear, if you can hear the guitar okay, if you can hear the microphone okay, if there's anything you need to hear more of or less of. Just let us know. We will endeavor to get that fixed for you. This is the first time that we're trying streaming from GI headquarters, but it is of course Monday night and we would not miss out on the opportunity to hang out with you guys and talk about guitar, because that's the thing we do on a Monday night. And as I'm sure you've noticed, right down here we're talking about fusion. Now specifically, we're going to be addressing some of the questions that we've had in recent streams about first steps into fusion. We're going to be talking about what you need to get into playing fusion guitar, the basic toolkit of skills that you might require. That's a very, very close reference to something a few friends of mine talk about, which I'm sure you all know. You will follow those guys on Facebook and on their podcast, etc., etc. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but first let's just check in with the stream and let's see what you guys have got. We have got so many friends in, so let's just go right to the top. Let's see who we have. We're just going to check in real quick with the streams. Matt, I keep pronouncing your name. I'm going to say it is Matt Hisco. It's two T's, I'm guessing, or it might be Matt with one T, it might be Matt Visco. But Matt says hello there. Matt, is great to have you. Who else do we have? Chris is saying, evening Nick, hope you're well. Could you tell me, do you prefer low output paths or higher output pickups, i.e. JB? Well, got a set of Fishman Fluences in here, and conveniently, this particular guitar does PAF and JB on a push-pull. But I generally lean more towards PAF-type pickups. We'll address that a little more in the Q&A, so when we get to that. Slider is saying, Slider317, saying, excited for this lesson. Marcin is tuning in. Who else do we have? Robert is saying, tuning in from high from New Hampshire. It's great to have you. Matt Burnett, friend of the stream. Six string Jim. Who else do we have? You can do fusion blues, right? Says six string Jim. You absolutely can. Hello from Pittsburgh, says Jerry. Who else do we have? Antigonus says hello from Paris, France. You guys are really challenging me with these usernames, by the way, but that is absolutely okay. Guitar Rock says Juan. It absolutely does. Absolutely does. Who else do we have? Geneva, Switzerland. Glasgow. We got people from all over the world. Blackpool. Amazing. Mark McNish, working from home from Idaho. It's great to have you guys on board. So we'll check in with some more comments from the stream in a moment. If you have questions, I would absolutely love, my boy John Page is in, says my boy John, it is great to have you. Thanks for joining us. John, I'm just around the corner from you tonight. I would have said for us to go for dinner, but unfortunately, I'm very happy that I can hang out here with you guys and talk about guitar. Anyway, let's get straight down into the meat of it. But before we do, a little bit of housekeeping. A few things. If you are enjoying these streams, the best way you can support them is by giving us a thumbs up or a like on whatever platform you're watching on, be that Facebook, Twitch, or on YouTube. You can share this with your guitar playing friends so we can get this out to as many guitar players as we can. We think this content's pretty valuable and we like giving it away for free. So it would be really cool of you if you could share it with some guitar playing friends. If you're getting some value out of this, you can also check it on the replay. You can watch this in its fullness on YouTube. So if you miss anything, you can always rewind and check it out at a later date. Also, if you fancy checking out GI Plus, this is the absolute best way you can support these streams. GI Plus is the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine. It is available at the link in the description. You can find all of our lessons that we've ever published in the magazine, but that is only a drop in the ocean compared to the rest of the content that we have there. We've got so much exciting stuff coming from you, and I've just been talking to one of our bass contributors. We're going to be doing some bass content in the not too distant future too, and that is also going to be pertinent for guitar players who are interested in improving their bass playing game. So anyway, let's get down to the meat of today's topic, which is of course first steps into fusion. So as far as fusion goes, let's start by defining our terms. Now, fusion would imply, and I had a conversation with this with a friend a little bit earlier on in the day today. Fusion would imply a combination of two or more things. It's a fusion of different styles of music. And while that is technically true, when we talk about fusion in the sense of what we're doing today, it generally refers to the fusion of jazz and rock. And what we mean by this is, well, it initially started in the 1970s with guys like Aldi Meola, even in the 1960s, guys who wanted to play jazz vocabulary with a rock sound and a rock attitude. So that's kind of what we're dealing with here. So it's not really the other way around. It's not really playing rock stuff with a jazz sound and a jazz attitude. It is jazz vocabulary with a rock sound and a rock attitude. Let's start by doing an example of what fusion probably isn't. So I'm gonna go to our backing track. We're using the Tom Quayle style backing track today, which is, it's available on the GI YouTube channel. Of course, you can find all of the backing tracks we use in these streams on the GI YouTube channel. So if you wanna check it out there, I would love that, that'd be great. So let's go to the close-up cam real quick. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna play over this backing track in the manner of a rock player, which is kind of what I am. I'm a rock guitar player. I dabble in fusion, but it's something that has informed my rock guitar playing. So I found it super valuable, even though it's not my main thing. But I'm gonna play over it in a kind of a rock style. I'll show you what fusion kind of isn't in this instance. So. Now, the eagle-eared among you will have probably spotted that I was basically playing the same phrase over each one of our chords there. It is very much kind of a typical blues rock type phrase. There's nothing wrong with playing that sort of stuff. That is my bread and butter. I'm a rock guitar player at heart. I love that sort of stuff. But as we previously discussed, fusion is about jazz vocabulary or jazz-influenced vocabulary in a rock with a rock attitude and a rock sound. To that end, I'm gonna put on a backing track that is not like especially fusion-y. I'm gonna put on more of a rock backing track, and I'm gonna try playing it in the sort of way that a fusion player might approach it. And let's see if this makes any sense to you. So we're gonna throw on the Led Zeppelin style live jam. This is the latest backing track that went up. It's on the GI YouTube channel right now. It went on Friday. You can pause this stream. In fact, no, don't pause this stream. Keep watching this stream. Once this stream is done, you'll be able to find this backing track on the GI YouTube channel. So this is in the key B. Let's go back to the close-up cam. I'll show you what I'm dealing with here. So here I'm gonna try playing over this rock style backing track. It's very, very quiet all of a sudden. I'm just gonna double check that that is the right track. Give me just a moment, guys. Like I say, we're dealing with a few gentle technical issues here. Oh, I see what I've done. I've been a bit of a fool, but that's okay. So here's our rock style backing track. I'll just have to fix that. But that's okay. Let's try playing this kind of in a fusion-ish idiom. Hard to exercise the rocker in me, but it's coming out there. But what you can hopefully hear from that is that even though we're playing in a rock context, the lines I'm playing are not your typical rock lines. Now, I should stress at this point, don't worry too much if you're having difficulty following the exact lines that I'm playing. This is not the point of this demonstration. It's literally just to define our terms. So, defining our terms, fusion is essentially jazz style vocabulary played with a rock sound and a rock attitude. Now, another important part of the fusion genre, which is very much a defining characteristic, is the harmony. So the harmony we tend to use in fusion settings tends to be what we maybe refer to as non-diatonic harmony. So this is harmony where the chords don't necessarily relate to each other within the context of a single key. Now this is quite important because this is something that does come up in both rock and in blues, and by learning how to handle this kind of material, even if you don't become a specialist with this stuff, just learning to handle it will improve your rock and your blues guitar playing. Examples of this might be something like The Boys Are Back in Town by Thin Lizzy, where we have this one rogue chord. I'm just going to double check. It isn't the key of G. I want to say it's in the key of G. I think I taught it an A for about a million years. It was one of the syllabus that I used to teach in. So in my head, The Boys Are Back in Town is still an A. Or I could have this the wrong way around and it could be in A and it's not in G. But either way, we have this chord. This one rogue E flat chord that doesn't really belong to the rest of the harmony. Knowing how to deal with things like that is going to make you a better rock player. Likewise, in a progression like a Stormy Monday type progression where you have this. Kind of vibe where you have this dominant chord that doesn't really belong to the rest of the chords. Knowing how to deal with that stuff is going to make you a better blues player. So this is pertinent even if fusion is not your main field of interest. But when we're referring to non-diatonic harmony, a really classic example is this YouTube-style fusion, and I don't use that term derogatorily. This is kind of like the boom of YouTube guitar players in 2011-ish sort of time, 2012-ish time. Would use these kind of tracks all the time. This style of backing track that we're using today, which again is available on the GI YouTube channel, is really, really emblematic of this particular non-diatonic harmony in that it's just parallel minor sevens. So today we're going to talk about some strategies that you might use over this backing track, because it's going to inform you in terms of your fusion guitar playing going forward. So what are we dealing with here? Let's start with the chord progression. So what we have is an A minor 9 or an A minor 7, doesn't really matter which, a C minor 9 or C minor 7, a D minor 9 or a D minor 7, and then we also have an F minor 7 or an F minor 9, like that. Now, these chords, I'm sure you agree, you know, I'm sure you'll have realized, don't belong to a single key. So you couldn't play a single scale over all of these chords. We have to treat each one of them individually, and this is one of the hallmarks of the fusion genre. It's something we refer to as playing through the changes, or playing over changes, sometimes people will describe it as. So anyway, if I throw this backing track back on, I'm just gonna talk you through the chord changes real quick, and then I'll talk you through my particular strategy for playing over said chord changes. So here's A minor. A minor 9, just so you can hear them. Here's C minor 9. Here's D minor 9, which is coming up. And here comes an F minor 9, which is right here. Now, probably the easiest way to treat each one of these chords is just to play Dorian from the root of whatever chord we're playing. So A Dorian. C. It's gonna be C Dorian. For D, we have D Dorian. And of course for F, so on and so forth. Now, just to be double sure, let's really quickly play through this together. So if you guys have your guitar, what we're going to do is I'm going to define some shapes for you, and I'm going to show you some positions where you can play it, and we'll back and forward a little bit. So I'm going to play it, and then I'll leave a little bit of space for you guys to play. So what we're going to have, this is just a little fun experiment. So let's say, for argument's sake, just if you're not terribly familiar with the Dorian scale, you know, you don't have to be for the purpose of a demonstration. Let's assume that you're familiar with a minor pentatonic. So we have A minor pentatonic, right here. And then we have C minor pentatonic right here. D minor pentatonic. And F minor pentatonic. Well, if we literally just throw in, go back to A real quick. If we literally just throw in this note right here, that's gonna be a second. And this note right here, it's gonna be a sixth. We get this shape. We'll be right back. were to just hang that on your pentatonic, you should be able to get through this backing track. So let's just do a little bit of an experiment. I'll play, I'll leave a bit of space for you to play, I'll shout out what you're gonna play, and maybe just give me a little bit of a noodle in that particular context. So let's start with A minor. I'm gonna play A Dorian right here. And I'll give you space. Next up is C. Here we go, C Dorian. I'll give you some space. Here's D Dorian. Again, give you some space. Here's F Dorian. So that little quick experiment should have hopefully showed you how this kind of thing works. So when we're playing these different Dorian scales, we're literally gonna hang each one of these on each of our minor chords. Now this is an introduction to an idea that we refer to as chord scale theory, which is the idea that the chord and the scale are interlinked and that you essentially treat each chord with a different scale. Now this is something that you will be doing by accident if you play, for example, G major over this common chord progression. So this common chord progression of G, D, E minor, and C, play G major over the top of that. You will be treating each one of those chords with a different scale, even if you don't know you're doing it. So we'll get onto that more perhaps another time. But as far as our Dorian goes, we can treat each of our minor seven chords with a Dorian mode. And this is a really safe first port of call for getting into fusion guitar. So if you come across a minor chord, you treat that minor chord with Dorian, unless there are some circumstances that would tell you otherwise. There are sometimes occasions where the chord would instruct you to play something other than Dorian, but if it's just a minor seven or a minor nine or even a minor triad, Dorian is your go-to. And you play that from the root of whatever chord is playing at the time. Now, if you happen to get a major chord, a major seven chord, or a major nine chord, or just a major triad, it's very unusual to get just a major triad in fusion, but even still, if you get a major chord, you would generally treat that with Lydian. And we'll get onto that another time, but that is generally the safest choice. Dominant chords are a little different, and that's something we'll get into in a future stream. This is gonna be the first of a series of streams for your first steps into fusion. But let's take this a little step further. So we have our Dorian. This time, we're gonna go to just E Dorian, and we're gonna stick with that Led Zeppelin style jam. So I'm gonna show you some more ideas here. So here's my E Dorian scale. I'm sure you'll agree sounds pretty cool, but it doesn't necessarily sound full-on fusion just yet. And this leads us to another important aspect of the fusion thing, which is something everybody really wants to know about. This is what people are actually asking when they're saying, how do I sound fusion? What people are actually asking is, how do I play that outside sound? That stuff that sounds wrong, but it doesn't sound wrong because I've put it in just the right context. Well, that's a question that we're going to answer a little bit of today, starting with the idea of including chromatic notes into your playing. Now, what are chromatic notes? Well, first of all, chromatic notes in the context of our Dorian scale are literally any notes that aren't in our pool of Dorian notes. So let's identify a few of them, right? So right here, in fact, tell me, you guys can tell me in the comments, we're in the key of E Dorian. I want to know what notes aren't in E Dorian. So the notes that are in are things like E, F sharp, G. You tell me in the comments what notes aren't in E Dorian. So drop me a comment, let me know. And I'll outline them as we go. So here's our Dorian scale. That's one octave of E Dorian expressed from G to G. Well, we're playing these notes, but this note, that's clearly not in the scale. This note is also clearly not in the scale. So we could consider those to be outside notes or chromatic notes because they're not in the scale. This note right here, that's not on our scale. Neither is this note. Neither is this note or this note or this note. You get the gist, right? It's basically any note that's not contained within your scale pattern. Robert Kugler has said F. He also has fine taste in music, by the way. There we go. Some fine fusion choices, more listening, if that's something you're interested in. So F is absolutely one of our choices. Now let me play you some Fs over this E Dorian style backtrack. Yuck, horrible. Disgusting. Let's try a different F. That one's no better. That one's horrible. That one, also horrible. Potentially even more horrible, right? So those Fs, boo. We do not like those Fs. However, we also, this is one for you blues players out there, don't like B flat in this context, but B flat is in our blues scale. And we know how to use B flat in a blues context. We know we use it as a passing note. So in my blues type playing, I wouldn't hang on this B flat unless I was being deliberately obtuse. Treat those B flats, we know how they work. With our chromatic notes in fusion, it's exactly the same because this B flat in your blues scale is just a suggested chromatic note. That's all it is. It's a chromatic note that is suggested by the scale. We have already established, if you've spent any time learning the blues scale, that the B flat is not the same as the other notes. It's not equal to the other notes in terms of its weighting. Marcine has identified the missing notes. We have Fs, A flats, B flats, Cs, and E flat, no less. There we go, there's our missing notes from our Dorian scale. So if we play those, we can get a truly awful sound. Let's try playing a truly awful sound over this right here. So let's play all of the notes that Marcin just outlined. So F, C is an F. Horrible, isn't A flat? Equally horrible. B flat, horrible. C, horrible. Absolutely foul, but, and here's the important bit, let's try peppering them in as passing notes, right? Let's try that now. So we'll wind this track back a little bit, or forward a little bit. Here we go. Not so bad this time. Now, because we're peppering these in as passing notes, they sound pretty acceptable. Now, that was a big old blur of notes, so I'm not expecting you guys to be able to go, oh yeah, I see exactly what he's playing, and play that. Let's try some easy phrases that you can use that use these passing notes, specifically an F and a C. So our passing note from F, we can use that to pass either up to an F sharp or down to an E. So a really common phrase that you hear all the time is one like this. Where we're passing from this F to this F sharp. And we can do the same thing from this C note up to our C sharp note or down to our B note, like this. So on and so forth. Now, other things we could do, we could pass from other notes, we could pass from a B flat up to a B, or down from our B flat to our A, or we could do E flat to D, or we could do E flat up to E. Those are all acceptable, but for the time being, Let's just try playing these notes. So for context, what we're dealing with here is the flat 9 going up to the 9 or down to the 1, or we have the flat 6 going up to the 6 or down to our 5. So we could play this, or we could play this, and they're both perfectly acceptable. Let's try it over the Zeppelin style track, and then we'll go back to our fusion track, and I'll show you how this applies as you move from one chord to another. So, Zeppelin style first, here we go. Did you hear it? There it was. You guys are picking up on that. You can see where I'm passing from these awful notes that are awful on their own into these kind of good sounding notes. Now, what I'm going to do here is I want to give you an analogy, and we've just ordered food, so I'm going to talk about food, right? We have food coming to GI Towers, and you can probably hear my stomach rumbling as we go because, man, boy's got to eat. I'm a big boy. I need my food. But I am postponing gratification so I can hang out and talk to you guys. The food analogy is, let's say, for example, you've ordered some chips or in the US, fries for you guys. Same deal, you've ordered some kind of delicious potato snack. Now what you might do, should do, is perhaps put some salt on your chips. Now salt is something that you wouldn't sit and eat on your own, unless you're very, very strange. You wouldn't sit and eat a bowl of salt. Just sit and chow down on a big, nice, big, fat, juicy bowl of salt. Says nobody ever. However, chips without salt or fries without salt, little bit bland. So if you pepper in just the right amount, not pepper, pun intended, if you sprinkle on just the right amount of salt, or in this case, just the right amount of wrong notes, you end up with something that is delicious by the inclusion of this element that isn't so delicious on its own. Hopefully that makes sense. And that is kind of an attitude that I take when it comes to determining how much of this stuff to include in a particular line. How salty do I want my chips today? Or how seasoned do I want my food today? There's also something to this, by the way, if you imagine it as spice, this is another pertinent thing. If you're cooking for guests, and let's say your guests were experienced culinary, like kind of people, and they love their food, and you can cook for them with loads and loads of spices, that's something that's okay, and they'll love you for it. They'll go, so many delicious flavors. Is that cardamom? You can tell I'm hungry, right? However, if you're cooking for your five-year-old nephew or niece, you're probably gonna wanna hold off on the chili, hold off on the five spice or whatever, because they're going to have a palate that's not used to that. This is something to be aware of when you're playing for different audiences or when you're playing in different contexts. Some styles of music and some audiences can withstand this kind of spicy or salty kind of playing better than others can. If you're playing it in a wedding band, maybe it's not the best time to drop all the fusion notes in the middle of Mr. Brightside. Perhaps the groom and bride won't thank you for it, but if you're playing your own gig and you're playing your own material or even just playing for your own entertainment, that is something you can absolutely throw in there. But the point I'm getting at here is don't get too hung up on being too hip if the situation doesn't call for it. Don't cook food that's too spicy for a children's birthday party. So the analogies are strong today, but let's carry on. So I said we were going to show you how this context works in our fusion type backing track. Let's do that right now. So as a quick refresher, what I'm going to do is I'll just show you the kind of scale shape that I'm going to work within. And you can try this along with me if you want. So what I'm doing here is I'm playing my A minor pentatonic, which I'm expanding into Dorian like this. One more time. And I'm adding this note and this note in as passing notes to get from either here to here, or here to here, or from here to here, to here to here, one or the other. And I will do this using the same shape in A, in C, in D, and in F as the backing track dictates. So let's throw that on, and you'll see what I'm doing here. Guys can see how that works. Now, the important thing here is not so much that we're playing a particular note, i.e. this B flat sounds pretty sour, this F sounds pretty sour. It's more the idea that certain intervals relative to the chord sound sour. Because what you would have noticed is that I couldn't just play the same note. Blue Summon, your comment's been up for a million years, so I'm just gonna get rid of that, but it is pertinent because we are talking about passing notes. It's kind of no good to us to think about the idea of a particular note being sour in a particular track, because when we move to the next chord, that note might not be sour anymore. So it's better to think of certain intervals relative to the chord as being particularly sour. So in this case, the way to think about this is flat nines, flat sixes, all sour sounding. Now, we can also use certain scales that are closely related, let's say, to our home scale, our Dorian scale, that are also gonna sound a little bit interesting when we play them. We can throw those into, and this is another way to get that kind of slightly outside sound in a way that is not too egregious. So we've talked about chromaticism as a way to create some tension and some spice in your music. Let's talk about some other scales. So what I want you guys to do in the comments is to rack your brains and have a think about scales that are like the Dorian scale, but maybe differ by one note or two notes. I'm gonna play some stuff, and I'm gonna see if you guys can figure out what's going on here. So drop me some comments with some scales that you think are closely related to Dorian. An example of one that's not closely related to Dorian, let's say, would be something like the Phrygian dominant scale. So here's Dorian. Close up camera real quick. Here's Dorian. Here's Phrygian dominant. Pretty different. I think they only have like four notes in common, which is the root, the fourth, the fifth, and the seventh. So, pretty different. So I'm gonna play some stuff that is Dorian-like. It's gonna have a similar kind of, let's say a similar note profile to our Dorian, but it's not going to be Dorian. It's gonna be a different scale. I won't tell you what it is, but you drop in the comments and tell me what you think is a good example of a substitute scale that is close to Dorian, but not too close. And I'm going to give you one that it's not. It's not Aeolian. So it's not the natural minor scale. Tell me what you think it is in the comments. Here we go. So some good guesses coming in already, but nobody's quite got it yet. So there are a couple of options we can do for this, and I'm gonna tell you what they are. So the first one, the one that I was playing there, which is a little dangerous, I was being perhaps a bit too egregious with that to sound truly musical, but I was trying to kind of give you guys a hint with this, is the melodic minor scale. Now let's do a quick comparison between our Dorian scale and our melodic minor scale. So if we take the formula from Dorian, in at the last slider says melodic minor. There we go, he's got it, Good man, well done. So melodic minor compared to Dorian. Let's just compare real quick, here's a formula. So if we were to take our Dorian scale from A, we have A, B, C, D, E, F sharp, G, and A. So our formula is 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, 6, flat 7, 1. Melodic minor is A, B, C, D, E, F sharp, G sharp, A. There's only one note difference. So the difference is rather than having a flat seven in it, it has a natural seven or a raised seven in it. It gives us this sound. Now, that's a cool sound, and it's one that you can use over a minor seven chord in fusion. I'm gonna throw these ones out here real quick. So, Lydian with that sharp four, people are saying Lydian. Lydian is a great choice for fusion, but you wouldn't use it over a minor chord because it's gonna clash pretty badly. You would use that as your chord of choice over a major chord. So if we had a major seven chord in this progression, we would absolutely use Lydian over that. And that is true anytime we have a rogue major chord. For example, if we are, just to show you Lydian real quick, I'll get back to melodic minor, but just to show you Lydian in its context, do I have the Whitesnake Ballad with me? I hope I do. You know, I don't believe I do, but I can give you an example all the same. So the we have an 87 ballad backing track. It's a Whitesnake style backing track. You can find it on the GI YouTube channel. Unfortunately, I don't have it with me right now. Didn't expect I'd need Whitesnake in a fusion lesson. Who knew? But when you're playing over Is This Love, right? And you get this. This F chord that comes out of nowhere. It's a rogue F chord, is the way I describe it personally, a rogue F chord. It doesn't belong to our key, so what we do is we treat it as its own thing and we play F Lydian in this instance. So that's where our Lydian thing becomes useful. It's over major chords. So we don't use it over a minor chord, but we can use melodic minor over a minor chord. Now, here's the deal. You have to be quite careful with it because the characteristic note in melodic minor is that raised seven. And if you don't play that raised seven, it just sounds like you're playing Dorian. So until you play that raised seven, it doesn't sound like melodic minor. However, the raised seven does clash against minor seven in our chord. So it's gonna sound a little tense when we hit the raised seven. Let me show you what I'm talking about. I'm gonna do it in the context of our Led Zeppelin style backing tracks. Let's throw that on real quick. Here's the Zeppelin style track. It's E Dorian. So the note you're looking for is when I play this note right here. That's the raised seven, that's D sharp. So when I play this note right here, against this E, it's gonna sound very tense. And you'll hear exactly what I'm talking about. I may also play it here, that's another D sharp. So keep your eyes peeled for that. I'll show you what's going on here. So here's the backing track. I'll start in Dorian. So this is Dorian. Guys, hear it? Hopefully you spotted that there. Now, when you start throwing in this melodic minor, because it's closely related to the Dorian, it feels like it fits, but something's just a little bit wrong. It's like, ooh, this is close to being right, but something just feels a little bit off. And that tension is part of the magic of the melodic minor in this context. So that's what we're doing, right? Maybe that's this context. So if we start throwing on our melodic minor, and we start throwing on this raised seven, we start to get this really cool tense type sound. Let's talk about some other scales that we can use to create some tense outside type sounds. Well, let's start by talking about the most right scale that we can play. You're in a minor key, you're playing a minor chord. What is the most right thing that you can play? You tell me, what is the absolute safest thing that's not an arpeggio, not the arpeggio of the chord? What is the safest scale that you can play? Drop it in the comments. I'm gonna play it for you right now. It is, of course, E minor pentatonic. We're playing the key of E minor pentatonic, all the safe. That would suggest to me that if we play notes that aren't E minor pentatonic, like this one, which is F minor pentatonic, we've got some good ones. Robert Kruger's got it. Matt Burnett's got it. Marcin's got it. Craig Walters has got it. It's pentatonics, absolutely right. E minor pentatonic, super safe. The pentatonics that are either side of this, by one semitone, by contrast, are extremely not safe. So if we play E flat, we've all done this, right? You've all done this when you've been jamming, you've been playing live, and you know, it's that spot, and you go, it is my moment, it's the big guitar solo, we're playing Freebird at Janice's wedding, and it's my moment, it's time to play the big solo, and suddenly you find yourself playing G sharp minor pentatonic by accident, and you go, oh no, disaster has happened. It's my Nick Jonas moment in the sun. Everyone on their smartphones will remember this. Well, you were just playing fusion, because if you play a minor pentatonic that is one step either up or down from your minor pentatonic of safety, you get some really interesting results. Let me show you. So here we go. Here's E minor pentatonic. Let me step up into F minor pentatonic briefly. You'll see me do it. Aha! Instant fusion. Let's try it again. Fusion is happening. So we can do the same thing if we step down into E flat minor pentatonic. Let's try that. This is a technique that we refer to as sidestepping. There is a little more complicated than that, a little more in depth than that, but you can think about it as just playing something safe, but a semitone out. And it's really easy to do on the guitar. It's something that horns find quite difficult because they have to, you know, pick a whole new scale and refinger the whole thing. Guitar players, we just play one fret out and it sounds pretty cool. You can do this with anything that sounds safe. So you can do it with, let's say Dorian. You can play Dorian one step out and get some interesting results. Pentatonics tend to work really quite well, though, because they're a really obvious statement that we're used to hearing. It's something very obvious, but juxtaposed into a situation where you're not expecting to hear it. And that's a cool way to sound kind of super outside. There are some other alternatives we can use. You can do whole tone scales, sound quite cool. You can do some diminished scales. The whole half diminished, which doesn't get a whole lot of love, works really well over a minor chord, which is this scale right here. That doesn't get a lot of love, and it works really quite nicely over a minor scale. The half whole diminished actually also kind of works, but they're another story for another day. We talked about what to play when it comes to outside outside notes. What we haven't talked about is when to play them. So the when is something we can take inspiration from another musician for, which is drummers. So if you think about a drummer, you think about a good drummer that you play with. James, our cameraman, happens to play with an absolutely fantastic drummer, right? James plays with Craig Blundell, who's one of, like, just titan of the business, right? James is just looking at me through a ring light with a big smile on his face. It's very, very cool. It's quite surreal. It's like a little James thought bubble has appeared. You know when the messages on Facebook Messenger come up and they're in a bubble? It's just James in a ring light, and it looks amazing. So anyway, James, great drummers anyway. What great drummers will do is great drummers will play in a groove, and they'll drop in and out of the groove and do things like fills. Let's say a fill is literally something that is not the core groove, but it's related to it, but it's a variation on. They'll do that at key points, such as when they're moving from section to section, or at the end of 4 or 8 bar loops or 8 bar sections. So the time that it's not right to play this, or not right, probably not advised to play this outside stuff, is right at the start of a section, like something like this. So right at the start of a solo. Works-ish. I might play my phrase here. Sounds a little bit so-so. But what I might do is I'll let this section pass. What I might do instead is I might play some outside stuff on the end of my 4-bar phrase. What you can pick up from what I'm doing there is by peppering in these spicy sounds, these kind of like outside type sounds, and then landing them in a strong place in the flow of the music, a strong rhythmic place, and a strong structural place with something that sounds very right, like a note from the pentatonic scale, it kind of excuses the horror show of outside notes that I've just played. So that's been kind of lesson number one. This is essentially how you might do, Blue Stillman's got it, like a drummer, doing fills. Exactly. Think about when your drummer does fills, that's a good time to play your outside stuff. Maybe not over the top of the fill, but you're probably going to end up doing it in the same place anyway. You can listen out at the backing track, by the way. All our backing tracks have the same sort of thing going on. You hear a drum fill, that's a good place to maybe throw in some outside stuff. Transitions from section to section. It's also quite cool to get from chord to chord. So you can blur the changes between chords by playing some outside stuff like this, for example. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to throw my fusion backing track on. This will be the last example. And I'm going to play this outside stuff when it's time to change from chord to chord. You'll see what's going on here, so. That again, not expecting it to follow the exact lines that I'm doing here, but that is a principle that you might use. Now, the important thing with this is not so much playing the exact things that I'm playing, but it's the general principles. So to recap, what we've done today is we've talked about the idea of how you might approach minor chords like a fusion player. We're going to be doing major chords and dominant chords in upcoming streams. We'll tackle those in the next couple of weeks. So this is just a partial introduction to how you might use some fusion type playing over a minor context. The reason we've chosen minor is A, we have a backing track that you can use. It's that YouTube fusion type backing track that works well, or the you can use it in any general minor context, because rock players, we tend to play over minor chords quite a lot. Blues players, you'll find it in minor blues. You get the drill, right? So that's kind of the gist of it. Let's leave that there. So there'll be some general principles about how you can use minor chords. If you want to go back over any of this stuff, you can, of course, catch it on the replay. It's going to be available for you on the GI YouTube channel. If you're watching it on here and you're not already subscribed, do subscribe. You get a notification anytime the backing track goes up, anytime a new stream starts. It helps us grow this stream and reach more guitar players. That's always good stuff. So subscribing is another way you can help these streams. In future streams, we're going to cover, like I say, some dominant chords, some major chords too, all that good stuff. But for the time being, I'm going to take a brief break to tell you a little bit about GI Plus and also to give you a chance to get your questions in, because we have not forgotten we're doing a Q&A at the end of this stream. So drop your questions in the comments. It says so right here. Drop your questions in the comments. I would love to know what you guys want to talk about. It can be fusion related, or it can be just general guitar playing stuff, whatever works for you, whatever you want to know about, we'll answer that. We've got about 10 minutes to do it in, so I'm going to give you a quick minute to drop your questions in the comments. In the meantime, while we're doing this, this is a little bit of a peek at GI Plus. If you want to support this stream, the best way you can do it is by checking out GI Plus. It is your exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine. It is crazy cheap for the amount of stuff you're getting. It's a very small monthly subscription, and you get just hundreds of hours of content, including unbelievable amounts of fusion. You can check out Tom Quayle's Modern Guitar course, which covers literally everything fusion related. You want to know how to be a good fusion player, it's in there. Anyway, this is GI Plus. I'll see you on the flip side of this to answer some questions. So get them in. Let's do this. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.
So
there you go, guys. That's a little bit of a look at GI Plus. Again, the best way you can support these streams is by checking out GI Plus. Consider signing up. There's so much great stuff in there. I can't begin to tell you. I've just recently finished shooting another course of my own for GI Plus. I'm going to be doing tons of them going forward, covering all of the questions that you guys have in these streams, which is quite interesting because this is a great way for me to find out what it is that you guys want to know about. So if there's questions that are coming up lots and lots, I'll do a course on it. So let me know if there's any particular courses you'd like me to do. I have an arpeggios one I think I'm just ruminating on because there's been lots of questions about our previous arpeggio streams. Another story for another day though. So anyway, let's check out some of your comments in the stream. So first question, right? So our friend Slider says, do you have any suggestions for first fusion songs to learn? I do not, because here's the deal. Fusion songs, not really a thing. Fusion is more a question of, it's not really a song art form. It is. There are pieces of music that are standards. Generally, you'll find jazz standards played in a fusion style that works. Generally speaking, what I'd suggest, instead of learning fusion stuff, I would suggest instead finding appropriate fusion backing tracks that you can figure out what to play over and practicing improvising, right? Practice improvising using what you think is fusion vocabulary, because here's the deal, right? There is no single rule, there's no single arbiter of what is and what isn't fusion, right? It's whatever you think it is. If you think it sounds like fusion, then it's fusion, and that's simply it. Now, in terms of expanding your vocabulary, listen to great fusion guitar players. So listen to Holdsworth, and listen to Tom Quayle. Right? That's a really great place to start. Tom's actually how I got my start in fusion. I was sat on a Yamaha teaching seminar with Tom, and I'd never seen someone play like that before. I was like, Jesus, what on earth is this? It was about 2007, I want to say. And here's me, you know, Mr. Shredder, hair down to here. I thought it was real hot shit. And then I heard Tom play, and I'm like, oh my God, I've never heard notes like that. That's unbelievable. You know, so yeah, listen to guys like that. Just have a try and take in the vibe, more than worrying about particular notes that they're playing. Just have a listen to the way they phrase, the sort of timings they use. Ah, here's a great one. Wayne Krantz, really fine example. Frank Gambale, another good one. Just have a listen to the, again, just the kind of the way these guys phrase, the attitude they have. It will start to seep into your playing as you develop your vocabulary. So, yeah, not a very good answer to that one, I'm afraid, but probably the best answer that you can have. Now, Marcin is asking, Is harmonic knowledge approach more important in fusion playing, more important than specific usage? I get what you're saying. Is it more important to understand the harmony than it is to have specific, specific chromatic things? I would say so. It's more important to understand the function of the notes you're playing, i.e., are they the minor third? Are they the fourth? Are they the fifth? Are they the flat five? Are they the flat seven, the flat nine, whatever? It's more important to think about that than it is to have specific licks or lines particularly. But this is true in any style of music. So understanding the function of the interval you're playing is kind of critical for this sort of stuff. We've actually got some great suggestions for particular songs that you might start with in their slider. There's a whole bunch of them. Try playing over. I clicked the wrong thing. Here we go. Try playing over A Remark You Made by Weather Report. Yeah, just great fun. You should definitely do that. If you're not sure how to play over that, we'll cover the bones of playing this sort of stuff and how you might choose particular scales or whatever kind of melodic structures over particular chords as these streams go on. So anyway, there's more questions here. Robert Kluger says, Pat Metheny's style doesn't sound like this. How do you refer to that style of sound? Quite difficult to categorize it. I wouldn't necessarily, and this is just me, this is my definition, I wouldn't necessarily consider Pat Metheny in the umbrella of fusion as I'm talking about it today. It doesn't mean he's not a fusion player at times, or doesn't play fusion at times, but it doesn't fall under that, that kind of rock attitude with the jazz vocabulary kind of thing. It's more what I would consider, I guess you could just call it a modern jazz style of playing, I would guess. Anyway, So let's keep going. We've got one more really great question that I want to answer. This is Darren Wall. Darren Wall is a friend of mine, taking some lessons with me too. Great guitar player and a fine chap, no less. Darren's saying, do you have any strategies for staying motivated when dealing with a plateau or struggling with a piece? I guess strategies is maybe, yeah, let's call them strategies. Why not? I will aggrandize myself by calling what I'm about to say strategies. I think the most important thing to recognize with this is that it's something that everybody faces when they're playing guitar, and it's not something that's unique to you. So everybody reaches plateaus in their playing where you don't feel like you're necessarily making the development that you want, and everybody struggles with learning things where you feel like the information is just not going in. It's a normal part of guitar playing, and it happens. And I think reconciling the fact that it happens and that it doesn't mean you're never going to get better or never going to break the plateau or never going to learn that piece. It just means that this particular piece or this particular plateau might be with you a little longer than you'd hoped it would. But that's normal. That happens, and it happens in every task that we undertake, every kind of pursuit. Let's say, for example, you want to be a better golfer, right? And you're struggling to take, I don't know, I don't play golf, picked a very bad analogy. But let's say, for example, you're struggling to improve your golf game and you feel like you've hit a plateau. That plateau is not going to be permanent. It just means that you're stuck at a particular level for longer than you hoped. Now, you don't necessarily have to change anything to, air quotes, break that plateau. You don't need to do anything differently. You just have to stay the course sometimes and just recognize the fact that it will pass. It's just a normal part of life. It's part of playing the guitar. So maybe that's something to do with it. Another thing, though, which is quite interesting as far as learning a piece goes, is sometimes the best thing to do if you're struggling to learn a piece is to go to bed. Obviously not if it's like, you know, 10 a.m. Don't like go, okay, I'm going to bed now. But sometimes the best thing to do if you're learning a piece is just to sleep. Now, the reason for this is that when it comes to the process of skill acquisition, a lot of skill acquisition is consolidated during sleep. Here's an example. If you've ever played an exercise or a piece that you're just finding really, really difficult and you're playing it well into the night and struggling like crazy with it, and then you get up the next day and try it and it's there, and you go, whoa, wait a minute, what's happened? That's an example of skill acquisition being consolidated overnight. So sometimes good night's sleep really is all you need. So there's some thoughts, Darren. I realize you have young kids, and a good night's sleep is not something that comes easily to people in your position, but still, it's something to think about. So anyway, guys, we've got so many more questions. I just want to answer them. So real quick, here we go. Robert Kugler says, listening also helps. It absolutely does. Listening to this stuff really helps. Any tips to avoid repeating licks or shapes? I do, but we're going to have to tackle that in another stream because we are running out of time, unfortunately. I'm going to have to say goodbye to you guys. So we've got loads of stuff here. An interesting question, right? Plateau, stop caring about it. Do yoga. Stop thinking about your musical problems and spontaneously play whatever comes in your head. Yeah, I can kind of agree with that, to be fair. Not a big yoga fan because, you know, I'm an amateur, recreational powerlifter, so I'm not terribly flexible. Maybe I should do more yoga, who knows? Anyway, guys, that's been a little bit of a look at Fusion. We're gonna be doing some more streams on this subject. If it's something you're interested in or something you'd like to see a course on, then do let me know in the comments. I would love to hear from you guys. We're gonna have to leave that there, but there's so much great stuff to talk about in the next stream. We've addressed some minor chords in this one. We're going to address strategies for major chords as we go forward. So there you go, guys. That's been a little bit of a look at first steps into Fusion. I had to look and see where that was there. First steps into Fusion, right down here. That's the one. I'm going to leave you guys there. But before we go, one more time, I'm just going to give you a quick look at the stuff that's in GI Plus. If you want to support these streams, do think about subscribing. I'm going to play a little bit, and then I'm going to show you what's in there. Keep your eyes peeled for the sourest of sour notes as we go on. My name is Nick Jennison for GI. I will see you guys next Monday, same time. Ooh, housekeeping. Just a quick one. We are now on GMT. So we're no longer on daylight saving time here in the UK. We are on GMT. So we'll be streaming at 8 o'clock PM GMT. So not GMT plus one every week from now on. So check how that affects your local time zone for when you see these streams. I would hate for you guys to miss it. So I know guys in New York, you change back from daylight saving time on the 7th, I think. I could be wrong. So check how that affects you. We'll be streaming 8 p.m. GMT, however that affects you. I'll try and keep the time zones up to date in the descriptions when I'm creating these streams, but man, what a head scratcher that is. I wish we could all just agree to, you know, just change them all at the same time. But anyway, check that out. That's when we're gonna be here, 8 p.m. next week, GMT. I will see you guys then. In the meantime, more Fusion. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.